today on My Voice, My Story, the 10th episode, very special one. We have Christina Van Toll, also known as CVT. She is a Senior Associate Athletic Director here at Boise State. She's also part of Student Athlete Services and a Senior Woman Administrator. CVT is amazing. She is a beautiful human being, and we are so lucky to have her on this podcast, and it is truly an honor. And I cannot wait for you guys to hear her story and be inspired by her. Okay, guys, we got CVT, Christina Van Toll. Really appreciate you coming on. And I say this a lot, but, you know, I really and genuinely mean this, but it's really an honor to have you on this podcast today.
That is so nice. When you asked me, I thought, man, Lex must have been at the bottom of the barrel. I'd do anything for you. And that's true. I would. So it's really a blessing to be here. Thank you for having me.
And I truly appreciate it. And I just want to let you know, too, this is the 10th episode, and you are the first non-student athlete on the podcast. So this is a big one.
Wow.
Yeah.
I get to be the double digit.
Yeah.
So is it fair to ask why you thought of me?
Well, honestly, I feel like you should be put in the forefront a little bit more. All the great things that you are doing around the athletic department, around this community, and being a part of it for so long, and being from Idaho, and being a woman in sports as a leader, I think we need to shed more light on that and just really give you your flowers. That's really the foundation of it, for real, to really get you on here and get to know you more.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
That's humbling. I think I've always kind of thrived in the background, so it's humbling to hear that. And I've been really blessed to have the years I've had here at Boise State and in college athletics, and I've been able to see a lot in my time and to work with people, to work with student athletes, coaches, staff. That's what makes it so exciting to come to work every day.
Yeah, that's awesome to hear. And Let's go all the way back.
Let's take it back. Okay.
Give us just your story, like your background, where you're from, your upbringing, mm-hmm. everything.
All right. I grew up in Parma, Idaho, which you'd know if you want to go see a movie outdoors, because we have a drive-in movie theater. Small farming community. My dad immigrated from the Basque Country in Spain. And went on to be an English teacher and my high school principal. My mom was a teacher. They met at College of Idaho. I'm one of four, and went to Gonzaga for college, both undergrad and master's, started my career there, and then got married a coach. So we went to Ontario, Oregon, because he was a baseball coach there, and I worked at the community college there. Did everything from running the concession stand to our gym burned down, so we had to raise money to build a new gym. Ran a college summer league baseball team, just did whatever we could do. And then the job at Boise State opened up, so I worked here for 5 years. And then I went to University of Portland, worked there because my husband had a coaching job there. Went to Gonzaga where he coached. I was a stay-at-home mom for 2.5 years, and then by then we had 4 kids, and Jean Blamire called me and asked if I wanted to come back to Boise State, so we did the circle and came back, and I was blessed to be by my parents, who at that time were both still living in Parma, and so we moved back to Boise.
It's crazy how Boise reels you back in once you've been here for one time. Like,
it does. It's tough to beat it here.
Yeah, no. And you growing up with your dad being your school principal and your mom mm-hmm. being a teacher, like, you could never skip school, huh?
Well, you got caught. I was a little smarter about it. My older brother was a little too obvious, so he did get caught. And you got in trouble at school, and then you got in trouble at home. And my dad was 6'8" and a really big man. And so, it was scary.
Yeah, no
so
messing with him.
You didn't want to get in trouble. So I was always pretty much a rule follower. There were 4 kids. 2 of us were rule followers. My brother and one sister, they lived on the edge a little bit more than we did.
Yeah.
So they got called into the principal's office a lot more than I did.
That's funny. But even hearing that background information, you've been a part of sports your whole life. Yeah. How has that, like, talk to me about just what it felt like as a little girl to be a part of sports like that. What did that feel like for you?
Well, you know, my dad just raised us, like, we were blessed. It was a small town. I had the keys to the high school gym. I could go up there whenever I wanted and play. We could get in any facility whenever we wanted and play, and it was a small town. So we were always on the field, on the court. That's what we did. And my dad had a unique story because, you know, being the child of immigrants, he never even played basketball till his junior year in high school. And then the coach at Ontario High School was Basque, and he drove out to the farm and he asked my grandfather, because by then my dad had grown 5 inches in one summer, and he asked if he could practice. And that really led to my grandfather never missed a practice or a game. He went on to play at College of Idaho, and that's really how he was able to get an education. Mm-hmm. And my dad saw, like, sports as the vehicle to teaching you about life, but also a way to get your education. And so he made it a thing with us kids. Like, if there was a sport to be played, we played it. Mm-hmm. And you could start whatever you wanted, but you could never quit. So right. He taught us, like, all those life lessons through sport. And my mom, you know, didn't have as many opportunities growing up, you know, when she did. And she was also the second oldest of 12 kids. So they had a really unique story as well. So she really wanted us to do all that. Like, we knew, like, if we did well in school and we worked hard in sports, we were going to be able to go to college, get an education, and do things. So our expectations were always really clear. Do well in school, work your hardest in whatever you choose to join, and go on to college. So my parents just always instilled that, and we all did.
Yeah, and it's crazy to hear you say that, because I get the same upbringing from where I come from and how my mom and dad were. And a lot of my, like, incentives for doing well, like, okay, if you get an A or you do well in this game or something, like, you get a new pair of shoes or something like that. But I remember, you know, my dad sat me down one time and was just like, hey, like, we don't have the money to pay for college.
Yeah.
So however you get there, it's going to have to be free.
Yeah.
So yeah, you can either invest all your time in basketball and get a good education and try to get there either through a full scholarship playing basketball or academic scholarship. But he was like, hey, look.
Yeah.
I can't help you.
Right.
Like, you have to go out and earn a scholarship in some fashion. And they were always hard on me about school and also about just performing well on the court as well. But
don't you think, like, it meant so much more, though, when you did it?
Oh, for sure.
It was like, because it's your blood, sweat, and tears that went into it. There's, like, nothing you take for granted about that.
No, not at all. And to have that support from them, especially emotionally and financially, too, with all the money that they gave me that they didn't have, you
right.
know, for me to be able to go and play AAU and be able to go to the high school I
yeah.
went to and things like that, like, it afforded me a lot of opportunities for me to sit here in front of you today. So
right.
you're forever thankful for that. And then you also, you know, feel good about the work that you've put in up until this point. So
yeah,
to have that instilled at a young age is crucial.
Right. I remember when I went to Gonzaga, there was never a time I walked around that campus where I didn't feel incredibly grateful to be there. I remember walking around going, wow, it is, you know, and I, you know, because it was just, you know, scholarships and student loans and different stuff to be there, and to be there on that campus, and to the education I received, the people I met, how I developed as a person. I remember just walking around going, thank you, God, that I can be here.
Yeah.
I never took it for granted, not once.
And that's something that it's hard for people to do, Mm-hmm. It's to be grateful in those moments until, because, you know, hindsight is 20/20. So when you look back, you're like, okay, I'm so grateful for, mm-hmm. you know, all these people, all the resources that I have. But when you can do that in the moment, that speaks volumes to your character and who you are and how you were raised. Because, like, for me, honestly, I wake up every day grateful to be here. And it's been such a blessing to have this experience and be around the people that I've been around and be a part of this community and Boise State University as a whole. And, you know, I kind of had to really learn that, because growing up playing sports, you always, what's next? Like, right. It was always that. And I never really sat back and said, I'm doing a pretty good job, so I'm grateful to be here.
You know, something you were talking about when you were sleeping in your mom's basement, when it didn't work out, yeah. You know, this plan you had. I was thinking about, like, it's funny how you go on life on this. You think of it as linear. I'm going to get here, and I'm going to accomplish this.
Yep.
And then there, that whole what's next thing.
Yeah.
And really, this whole idea of, well, it's a country song, but life really is a dance. Like, through, nothing is ever wasted. That time when it didn't work out for you to go pro, and you were in your mom's basement and you were thinking, what is my next step? Like, none of that was wasted.
Right.
That is building your character, building your testimony. It's who, like, part of who you are, and like, you're a better person because of that.
Right.
And no, and exactly. It took me a long time, I think, to really get that kind of perspective, no matter what happens, because there is hard stuff every day. Mm-hmm. Nothing is wasted if you choose not to waste it.
Right.
So you can dwell where you are. You could have just, like, I'm gonna pout in my mom's basement, or I'm gonna figure out what my next step is.
Right.
And you did. That's so cool.
I'm happy to be here. I'm happy I did that.
We're happy you're here. We're happy.
Yeah, because sitting down there, I mean, going through COVID and all mm-hmm. that stuff, like, it really helped me, like, look within. Mm-hmm. I think that was the biggest thing, just finding internal happiness no matter what was going on externally.
Yeah, I think that's the difference between happiness and joy. You know, happiness is fleeting. It's so dependent on what's happening around you. Mm-hmm. Joy is that internal presence.
Yeah.
And I think that's where you can have joy in the hardest of times.
For sure. And one thing I noticed about it, too, is when you are, like, having good thoughts and positive energy, like, within yourself, everybody else sees it, and it rubs off on people. Mm-hmm. So I think that is also a good way to look at it, too. Like, hey, if you really want to make an impact on somebody that you're around on a daily basis, or people that are looking at you from afar, maybe even look up to you, just walk with that.
Right.
Because it'll show.
Right. People just thrive on genuine connection. Mm-hmm. And people know when you really care.
Yes,
and when you're
absolutely
faking it.
Yeah.
And to really ask someone, how are you, and to listen for a response, and to be vulnerable enough to say, I'm not good.
Right.
Like, when someone says, I'm not good today, one, it takes a lot to say that, and then how you respond if you're the one that asked the question.
Right.
It means a lot to that person. So I think, I don't know, Lexis, when I'm around you, I see what I see is, like, this genuine person that is fully present where he is. And I think that's what draws people to you.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. And that's what I try to be. I just try to be where my feet are. I know I have these big goals and plans for myself, but, you know, just enjoying every moment, because, like you said, this is not wasted. Mm-hmm. It is going to help me wherever I end up, and I'm just grateful.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really am.
Yeah, yeah.
So that leads me to my first question of being, so you grew up in sports and everything. How did you really think about becoming an administrator? Like, where did that come from? I did some research. You know, we do some research on this podcast.
There you go.
So you started out being, like, an academic advisor?
I did, yeah. So I had a work-study job. So part of the way I paid for college was I had work study. So the first thing I did when I got to Gonzaga is I basically dropped my bags off in my dorm room, and I went to the athletic department and I asked if I could have a job. So I had no idea what I wanted to do. I just really knew I loved athletics. And so I checked IDs. So it'd be the equivalent of our fitness center here on campus where you scan your IDs. Well, back then we had a card and you had to show it at a table. And that's what I did. That was my work study job from 6 to 10 every night. And then from there, it was a small department then, and I just got to know people, and I just kept meeting people. And by my senior year, the NCAA had just come out with academic enhancement money, where they gave each school $5,000 to use towards academics. And so they didn't use it all for me. They gave me a little bit, and my role was to help basically tutor and in academics with the student athletes. So that's how I started. And then when I was going to graduate, they turned that into a graduate assistant position. And so, yeah, I was an academic advisor, then got into compliance. Mm-hmm. And then the NCAA came out with the senior woman administrator title, so this whole SWA title.
Yeah.
And there was, I think there was three of us in the department, three females. There was the secretary, an athletic trainer, and me. And we had female coaches. And so the athletic director at the time, Dan Fitzgerald, he's like, he offered it to me. I had no idea what it was. I was like, yeah sure, you bet.
Yeah.
So in a way, I kind of fell into it.
Uh-huh.
I always knew I wanted to do athletics in some sort, but I just was really blessed with meeting people that would listen to me and listen to these ideas I had and go, like, I wanted to start a women's group there. Just get different women on campus and have different, have us all come together and just learn from one another. And they were like, yeah, sure. And they just empowered me to go and do things like that. And so I just kept learning. And so I never really felt a ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
My parents never really said there were things I couldn't do. And then when I got to Gonzaga, they didn't either. They were just, I'd come up with ideas and they'd let me run with it. They'd give me a few guardrails. And so I really, my time there, I learned so much because people just allowed me to do that. And I've worked for 8 athletic directors and they've all been unique, but they've all really given me a chance to grow and learn and be humbled.
Mm-hmm.
Get back up, try again. So I've been blessed in this business.
No, for sure. And, you know, just thinking about taking all of that, you know, growth and knowledge and learning experiences, speak to us about just becoming a leader and creating other leaders as a woman in sports.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think being true to who you are is super, super important. I think when I first, like my first time around at Boise State, I got hired at, I think, 26. And I really was trying to be what I thought they needed me to be instead mm-hmm. of who I was. And what I try to instill in all people, especially young women, is be who you are, know what you stand for, know what your non-negotiables are, and be okay being you. Like, whoever you naturally are, be authentic. Because mm-hmm. I think the greatest thing about leaders, when you're authentic and genuine, people respond to that. It's when you try to be a character you're not.
Mm-hmm.
Like, how I approach hard conversations, how you do different things. It needs to align with your value system. So that's first and foremost. Like, if you don't know what you stand for, spend some time on that.
Yeah.
Spend some time on your core values and your who you are as a person. Because you need to have that when you go into these leadership roles. And I learned a lot. I had a lot of great mentors. And probably my greatest training ground was being a parent. A lot of what I do now, I think I'm blessed to have four kids in this age group we get to work with, this, you know, 18 to 23-year-old realm. And the time I spent at, when I got out of the business and I was a stay-at-home mom, when I came back into the business, I felt like I was a better leader when I came back in, simply from leading in my own house.
Yeah, for sure.
It goes back to nothing's ever wasted. Like when I got out of college athletics, when we did one of our moves, I didn't think I'd ever get back in. But then when I was able, you know, I say God knew where he wanted me. And when I got back in, I feel like I was better prepared the second time around because of getting out of it and gaining that perspective.
Yeah, and it was all the purpose behind it. And just to speak to you talking about staying true to yourself, I was recently just thinking about just how young people feel as they continue to elevate and they get in these rooms that they've never been in before and started picking up responsibilities that they've never had and are trying to grow. I think sometimes when you are trying to be somebody you feel like they need you to be, you feel a little bit of a imposter syndrome.
Absolutely.
And you feel like the room is too big for you. And, you know, to anybody that's listening that's in that space, you know, the one thing I would want them to know is, hey, you've put in the work to deserve to be in that room. You deserve to be a part of that conversation that's going on, and your input matters. And because you are you, you're special. That's your superpowers, being you. Because I think, you know, when you're go get the coffee or, you know, those internship roles and, you know, maybe you're a manager on a basketball team doing the laundry and stuff. Like, if you want to coach or you want to be an administrator, you're going to be asked to do some things that you've never done before. You don't even know what that looks like. And it does not matter. You know, everybody started off not knowing exactly what to do. And for you to be able to fall back on those core values and understand who you are as a person and really be comfortable with that, it'll help you as a leader because – you know, I feel like I'm in that situation right now as I continue to grow in my role and continue to seek things that I can be doing and opportunities that I can take to grow as a person, to grow just as an employee, as a staff member, that one day I will be a leader. And I know that I'll deserve to be there.
Well, I think everyone's chosen for a purpose. And like Lexis, you're in the role you're in because you add such value. And there's things that you bring to that team that no one else brings. And I was talking to one of my counterparts. We just had league meetings. And she goes, I'm a little overwhelmed. She's young in the profession. And she was listening to the people in the room. And she was having just that, like, should I be here? But I tried to tell her, I'm like, do you understand? Like, you're bringing this fresh set of eyes. You're bringing a perspective that's different that we need to hear. And you don't need to have 25 years of knowledge. Like, we'll all build each other up. We'll all exchange, you know, cell phone numbers. And, like, if you need the nuts and bolts of how to handle a situation or whatever, we can help you with that. But you're bringing something that's unique and special, and use your voice in the room because we need to hear it. And I think that in everything, like, we are so much better when, like, people lead up. Like, I need to hear other people's opinions, and I need to let it, like, sink in. You know, I think about our support staff. I'm so blessed to get to work with, you know, our sports performance, health and wellness, our academics, Bronco Life, and you know, I met with Zach last night and stopped by and their dinner. And I listened to them, and it's, like, inspiring. And it makes you go, oh, my gosh. Without that, like, it's just, it would be so boring.
No, for sure.
So boring.
Yeah.
That fresh energy, new ideas. And, no, you're there for a reason. Like, nothing about you being here is an accident. Both from Boise State's side and, you know, from my perspective, like, God plants you where he wants you. For and sure. I really see, like, all my work now, I'm able to look at it and go, like, okay, this is my mission field. Mm-hmm. So, okay, God, what do you have for me today?
Yeah.
And I think it's a different way to look at it, to where I used to be like, what's next? And now it's like, okay, what's next? Might be working at the gas station. I don't know, but I got to be open to that.
Well, we know that's not going to be the case.
If that's where God wants me, you know?
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, like, if you look at it like a mission field and how can you impact people?
For sure.
But yet, the more I work on impacting the people, others, the more like I feel people impact me. Mm-hmm. And it goes back to what you were saying, like, when you're given of yourself to people, how much you get in return. Mm-hmm. I really feel that, like, the more you said you try to be fully present where you are and people see that, I feel like you give energy and then people give it back.
Exactly. It's all about what you put out there. You know, if you're putting out good and positive energy, it'll come back to you. And it'll come back to you in ways that you didn't even think could happen.
Right.
Like with you, you know, like you said, being a stay-at-home mom and being like, oh, how do I get back into the business? But because you were, you know, raising kids and doing it in such an amazing way, the universe and God just said, hey, it's time. Yeah. I think you're ready.
Yeah.
And that's special because we never know exactly when we'll be ready. Mm-hmm. It's always that, oh, I'm not ready yet. I think I need a little bit more. Right. I'm not ready for that. But when you just dive in and things come your way, just, you know, take the opportunity. Like, I talked to you about, you know, doing that keynote speech yesterday. Like, that's nothing that I ever thought I would do in my life. But that's who I see myself becoming. And those are the type of things that I will have to do over and over again. And to have that opportunity, if I would have said no, how can I ever look at myself and say, hey, you want to be an athletic director one day? You can't give a keynote speech. Right. You know?
I think it's so great. And I guaranteed there were people listening to you that went, okay, I want to do that. I want to.
I hope so.
And then, like, you're inspiring the next generation. How cool is that?
I know, yeah. And it seems so, like, big to say that. But in actuality, like, that's what's happening. That's the reality of what's going on. So, I mean, for you to be inspiring so many women across the country to see you and your role and people here at Boise State, like, it's a big deal every day. And I know you go through each day like, I got to do this, I got to do that, or this meeting's coming up, I got to have this hard conversation. I mean, it all adds up, and people respect that.
Well, thank you. Thank you for saying that. We have really, really great people here. This place, it's special because of the people in it, not because of the successes. That's an outcome.
Right.
But the people that make up this place are special, and I really don't take that for granted at all, that we're blessed to be here.
For sure. And speaking of this place, you know what's next.
I don't.
You don't. He does. So every episode we do a top five segment.
Okay.
So let's see where this goes, okay? So speaking of just Boise, you've been here for a little bit, and this is your second stint here. What are your top five restaurants in Boise? Your top five, like, what you like the most?
You realize I don't get out a lot. Olivita is really good.
Okay. What is that?
It is by the Fork, which also is on my list.
Okay.
Eppies. So Olivita is an Italian restaurant.
Okay.
Really small, really, really good.
Next to Fork downtown?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Eppies, if you like Basque food, which of course I do, that's out Meridian. That's epic if you haven't eaten there.
Sheldon did not tell me that. I just wanted to let you know that.
Okay, Dom should be eating at Eppies. He really should. Or he might, maybe he can cook the food, but I don't know. Let's see. Oh, there is a Cuban restaurant in Overland that I really like. been to the Cuban restaurant. Dang it.
Where in Overland?
Overland and Curtis area.
Okay.
Really good Cuban
food. Is there like a Planet Fitness over that way? On Overland?
Oh, I don't think, not that area. Yeah. That's good.
Casablanca?
And let's see. I really like Thai food. So Thai ginger's good.
Where is that?
Also on Overland. You can tell I live west.
Yeah.
So I start driving up that way, and it's what I can find that way.
Okay, so we got Olivita,
Fork. Eppies.
Eppies.
You got to go to Meridian for it. It's worth it.
Hey, I will.
It's so good.
I will.
It is really authentic, really good.
Okay.
Thai
ginger.
Thai ginger, and what was my other one?
Casablanca.
There you go.
Okay. I'm so happy you're on here saying that, because a couple
of these. What are your top five?
Mine?
Yes.
In Boise. Hear it. In Boise? Eureka.
Ooh, that is good.
I love Eureka.
That is good.
You know what everybody says?
What?
Tupelo Honey.
I almost said that.
You did.
I almost did. Yes, that is good.
Everybody says that.
It is good.
I love breakfast in Boise.
Oh.
So the griddle.
The griddle. Yes. My daughter worked there. I ate there a lot. Love the griddle.
Yeah. Love the griddle.
Love the griddle.
I'm going to have to say barbacoa.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Really love good. Barbacoa.
Guacamole.
Oh, the spicy. I get it spicy.
Yeah, that's really good.
And we've had a lot of student athletes on here, so they haven't really said barbacoa like that. But
well, maybe with enough NIL money.
I know, right? Yeah. Barbacoa, you got to step in. You get some more business out of our student athletes.
Get the NILs going.
So that's three. Eureka, the griddle, barbacoa.
Five is a lot.
It is. You have to eat.
Maybe enough. We need to go top three.
You think so? For restaurants, that's a lot. I could think of two more for sure.
Because I'm always, well, what are they?
I'm trying to think of something local. Keeping it local.
I really like
Tin
the
Roof. Tin
Ooh,
Roof.
Tin Roof's good.
Tin Roof. In my fifth, there'll be another breakfast spot.
Goldie's.
Nope. Oh. Big City.
Oh, yeah.
Love Big City. Love Love Big City.
Yeah.
So those are my five.
I should have thought of breakfast. I am a big breakfast gal.
I try to, like, especially last season, which was my first season, I tried to treat myself to breakfast every Sunday.
Love it.
That was like my self-care day.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. The griddle and barbacoa on my 25th wedding anniversary, we did a lot of eating. We started out at the griddle and we ended at barbacoa.
That's a wonderful day.
It was like a solid eating day.
That is a great day.
Yes.
Shout out to Addie's too. I like Addie's breakfast too. Shout out to Addie's. Okay, your next top five, and I'm putting you on the spot here, and you might ruffle a couple of feathers. Your personal top five student athletes you've got to work with.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
This is awful.
Yeah. I'm putting you on the spot.
Lord, I've been doing this 30 years. Can't even like remember names. Roberto Bergeson.
Okay, shout out Berto.
Berto is an all-time favorite of mine. Well, I've worked with some unbelievable people. Another one, former student athlete, Anne-Marie Kaus, when she was a gymnast. Anne-Marie Johnson now.
Okay.
So many. So, so many. This is tough. Okay. Okay, let me switch it. My gosh.
Berto made the list, though. That's
Berto. So I think it's his silver anniversary, because I was just looking at, he was class of 99. So when I first started out here, Berto was here. Yeah, he's all-time great. This is so hard. This is like picking your favorite kid.
Well, you got one.
Do you have a favorite kid? You have to have a favorite kid.
Don't make me do that.
Yeah, I'm not going to make you do it right now.
What is the off chance they might listen to this? This would be terrible. It is my daughter's birthday today, so I have to say shout out to my daughter Amaya. It's her birthday today.
Shout out to her.
Okay. Golly, can we do a next top five? This is so terrible. Like, seriously, I was at the tennis tournament, and one of our sweet tennis players comes up to me, and she goes, "Don't take this the wrong way. Having you here is so great. It makes me feel like my mom's here." It was so sweet. So I just gave her a big hug. I'm like, "Hey, that's awesome." Because when you're in your 50s, you just take whatever you get. I just gave her a big hug. I thought that was awesome.
Okay, let's help you out. Now you pick two athletes. If you can think of another one, that's fine. But let's add coaches in there. Mm. Favorite coaches you work with?
Beck Rogar.
Okay. Yes. Shout out to Beck.
Shout out to Beck. Gordy.
Gordy. Shout out to Gordy. Two amazing human beings.
Yeah. Coach Pete.
Coach Pete. Yep.
Phenomenal. I've gotten to work with some great ones. Neil Resnick, former gymnastics coach.
Okay.
He taught me something every time I talked to him. Never had a conversation where I didn't walk away being like, wow, that was really, really good.
Last one.
Sean Garris.
Okay. Shout out to Sean Garris, who is also an amazing golf player, I heard.
Yes, and his son, amazing golfer.
That's what I heard, yeah.
Yeah. So, but I could go on and on. Because at different schools too, different coaches I've worked with, for sure. Yeah.
Well, we got to put you on the spot. That was the hot seat for a
little know.
Bit.
The student athlete one now, that is just, woo.
Yeah. You can't say too many.
I know.
And when you leave somebody off, they're going to be like, CBT. Oh,
I started thinking of names in my head, and then I was like, well, if I say that one, then I got to name these three, and then I'm at my five, and then that's bad.
So, yeah. They get left off the five, they're going to be mad.
Yeah, yeah.
Last question. So you've been doing this for a long time, and, you know, every year is different. And one of the things I also like to ask the student athletes is, you know, when this year is over, and it'll be soon because the school year is ending, graduation this week, what is one thing you want to take away from everything that went on this year? Just as far as your personal growth, professional growth, things that you've learned, what's the one thing that you feel like you can take away from this year?
I don't know if I'm right on point here, but there is true joy I'm taking away because I feel like we were finally back. After COVID, like last year we were somewhat and we weren't there. And the coolest thing this year was feeling like you were fully in, engaged, present, full rooms, you know, going to sporting events and it's packed, going to Connect for Bronco Life and seeing all the, like, just being fully present is so cool. And I love the graduation receptions we'll have on Friday, both for our graduate assistants and for our student athletes. It's such a moment of joy when you see that relief on their face and you see the joy with their parents there or significant others, guardians, whoever gets to join them, it's like you go, wow, that's why you're doing it. And I'm really blessed because then the next day I get to watch my own son graduate on the blue. So that's super cool.
Yeah, that is.
That's just a nice feeling to have.
No, that's an awesome answer. And you are right on point. And, you know, just once again, I just really want to thank you for taking the time to do this. You're very busy, but to really take this time to come and do this podcast, I mean, that's special. And this is a special episode, and you're a special person. And like I said before, you know, the reason I decided to choose you is because I want to give you your flowers. You deserve them now and always. So really thank appreciate you and everything that you're doing, and looking forward to see what more you do.
Thank you. And really, really humbled, like I said, and totally, totally appreciate it. And if I could just say one thing, I think it's so important, these podcasts where student athletes get the chance to share their stories. Because I feel like the more people share their stories, the more we understand one another, and then we really get somewhere in this world. Because like you said at the beginning, there are so many differences people have, but the more you can know people's hearts, we can get past so many things, because you can, you don't have to agree with everything they say,
right?
But you can appreciate and love them for who they are. And I just appreciate this platform, you know, for myself, what a blessing. But for student athletes to be able to share who they are with others, I think it's just, it's super cool. So yeah, thank you for doing it.
Yeah, no problem. And we always talk about telling our story. You know, we have to be able to tell it. And for people to hear it, see it, understand it, and run with it, you know what I mean? And really get on here and be vulnerable and give people some type of insight to who these student athletes are outside of their uniforms, because they are big deals.
Yeah.
Like, they're special people.
Yeah. And if I could say anything, I never get around to all the practices as much as I want to, every competition like I want to. But if there's ever a student athlete that needs anything, be it just a safe place to sit and relax or have a conversation, or you have a problem or you don't know what to do, my office truly is always open. Even if, you know, I'm busy, get my cell, get my email, call me, because I really do want to be a place where student athletes feel like they can come and talk. So I just want to put that out there.
Yeah, student athletes, take heed to that. Yeah. Seriously.
I mean it. I'll restock the licorice too.
Well, on that note, that's the episode. We appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank you.